ॐ सहनाभवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। Their devotees, at the outset, let me express my greetings to all of you on revered Swami Gitanandaji Maharaj's birth anniversary. As announced earlier, I will speak to you about the essence of the Kathopanishad. The Upanishads form the concluding portion and contain the essence of the Vedas, which are the scriptures of the Hindu faith. They record the direct and immediate spiritual experience of the rishis, the seers of truth, and have been passed down orally through a succession of illumined teachers. They deal with the origin and destiny of the soul, the nature of the universe, and the nature of ultimate reality. In these Upanishads, the divinity of the soul, the oneness of humanity, and the oneness of God are discussed not as articles of faith, but as the truths of spiritual experience. Schopenhauer once said, "The Upanishads are the most rewarding and elevating reading possible in the world. They have been the solace of a life and will be that of a death." There are 108 Upanishads. Sri Shankaracharya, the great teacher of Advaita Vedanta, wrote immortal commentaries on 10 Upanishads. But due to its most poetic and charming presentation of the sublime doctrines of the Vedanta, the Kathopanishad has ever been a great object of interest to scholars, both of the East and of the West. There is immortal treasure in Vedanta or the Upanishads. Swami Vivekananda wanted the truths of Vedanta to become living and vibrant in our practical life. He wanted these truths to enlighten our minds and hearts of millions of people round the world. He firmly believed that the wonderful rational system of Vedanta will be the future religion of humanity. The Kathopanishad is widely read both in the East and in the West. The knowledge of the self is here discussed in a lucid style, almost unparalleled in the philosophical writings of the world. Max Müller has said that the French, German, and English translators of the Upanishads regard this treatise as one of the most perfect specimens of the mystic philosophy and poetry of the ancient Hindus. Like all the Upanishads, the Kathopanishad aims at inculcating the knowledge of Brahman, which alone, according to Vedanta, enables a man to attain immortality or freedom. As the subject is profound and difficult to grasp, the Upanishad, following an ancient Hindu method, begins with an illustrative story. There once lived a rishi whose name was Vajasravasa. He performed a sacrifice which demanded that he should give up all his possessions and should distribute all his wealth among the Brahmins. He had faith that when he had sacrificed all that is transitory, the reality will come to him. He had a son, Nachiketa. He was about 15 to 16 years of age and cherished a reverence for spiritual things. When the cows were brought for distribution among the Brahmins and priests who were to conduct the sacrifice, Nachiketa found them to be old and unfit for any use. Such an unworthy gift, the boy realized, would only bring misery to his father after death. He was filled with Shraddha, which Shankaracharya defines as Astikya Buddhi, the totality of positive attitudes. It is the firm faith in infinite soul, the infinite power within. And so, since Nachiketa was eager to save his father from this impending calamity, he said to him that a son was also property and should be included among the things for distribution. He wished to know, therefore, to whom he was going to be given. Three times he asked the question, but Vajasravasa was only annoyed by what he regarded as audacity on the part of his son. And he answered angrily that he would give him to Yama, the king of death. Nachiketa obeyed his father and went to the abode of Yama. Yama is the ruler of death and the bestower of punishments and rewards. Moreover, he is regarded as a teacher of the knowledge of Brahman. Yama was away from home when Nachiketa arrived. As a result, he had to wait for 3 days and three nights. After returning home, he was frightened when he saw Nachiketa. He said, "A Brahmin stay at home for 3 days without receiving any hospitality was not a good sign for any householder." He sought to compensate for not having been there to receive his worthy guest for any discourtesy that might have been shown to him during his absence by allowing him 3 boons, one for each night. Nachiketa asked as the first boon the removal both of his father's anger and of his anxiety on account of his son's absence from home. As a second boon, he desired to know the fire sacrifice by which one goes to Brahmaloka, the plane of Brahma, and enjoys there a long life of felicity, free from disease and old age, sorrow and fear. Nachiketa, on his part, repeated the details of the sacrificial fire as was told to him. Yama was struck by the sharp intelligence and memory of Nachiketa. He gave him an extra boon by saying, "Henceforth, this fire sacrifice shall bear your name." Both boons were granted. Then, with the asking of the third boon, the teachings of the Upanishad begins. Nachiketa's third boon was this: there is a belief that after a man is dead, he is gone forever. Others believe he is still alive. Which of these is true? What exists after death? Nachiketa thinks that an answer to this question can alone make life meaningful and worthwhile. Otherwise, human life will appear pointless to a thinking mind. It is no wonder that this question has agitated the minds of serious seekers of truth in East and West, ancient and modern. In the very opening paragraph of his famous lecture on immortality delivered in America, Swami Vivekananda refers to this eternal subject. What question has been asked a greater number of times? What question is nearer and dearer to the human heart? What question is more inseparably connected with our existence than this one, the immortality of the human soul? It has been the theme of poets and sages, of priests and prophets. Kings on the throne have discussed it. Beggars in the street have dreamt of it. Often in the turmoil and struggle of our lives, we seem to forget it. But suddenly someone dies and the soul asks the old question, what after this? What becomes of the soul? A teacher, however, must first test the fitness of his student before instructing him in the secret of Atman. If the latter is to assimilate this knowledge, he must have cultivated keen discrimination, complete detachment, a sincere longing for truth, and a tranquil mind. He must have renounced all desire for the perishable pleasures, both of the East and of heaven, both of earth and of heaven. Therefore, Yama offered Nachiketa various temptations, both earthly and celestial, such as sons, grandsons, wealth, cattle, vast empire, long life, and heavenly damsels and music. It is incredible. In one sentence, Nachiketa discards worldly pursuits by saying, Navitena tarpaniyo manushyo. Man is never satisfied with wealth. Nachiketa was totally unimpressed by the alluring prospects held out by Yama. His mind sought truth and nothing but truth. The young aspirant, endowed with a sharp intelligence and calm mind, discarded them all, since he knew them to be impermanent. Since he was a seeker of immortality, he persisted in his determination to pierce the veil that hides self-knowledge. And Yama granted him his destined desired boot. Yama was immensely pleased. He was proud of this young boy who had stood the severest of tests and established his fitness to receive and to benefit from knowledge of the truth asked for in his third boon. And using the subject of the boon as a starting point, he proceeded to impart to him the highest wisdom. This forms the theme of the remaining chapters of the Kathopanishad. We are simply fascinated with this firm resolve on the part of Nachiketa. Nanyam tasmat Nachiketa vrinite. No other boon, therefore, than this shall Nachiketa choose. Nachiketa never wavered even once. He illustrates in its highest and purest form what the Gita calls Vyavasayitmaka Buddhi, one-pointed determination. Vyavasayatmika Buddhi, one-pointed determination. He illustrates this type of character that is emphasized in Vedanta. This reveals a mind that seeks truth and nothing but the truth. It is prepared to face suffering, privation, and even death itself in the bargain. Yama told Nachiketa that in this world there are two courses of action, the one leading to Shreya or the highest truth, the other Preya, which is apparently very pleasant but short-lived. If we pursue what is pleasant, we miss the highest truth. But if we go after that which is good, we miss what's pleasant. In other words, the two paths are mutually exclusive and contradictory to each other. The acceptance of the one implies invariably the rejection of the other. The desire for prayer is the quest of wealth, power and pleasure. But the quest of Shreya is different. It is the quest for spirituality. It is the quest for that character which will digest all wealth, power and pleasure. Without this spiritual energy, wealth, power and pleasure will corrode the human soul and make man small in stature. The main theme of the Kathopanishad is not survival or reincarnation. These form only suggestive clues to what all Upanishads seek, namely immortality. The Upanishadic rishis realized that to be deathless also involved being birthless. Anything that is birthless and deathless cannot be finite. It must be infinite. Further, the infinite cannot be two, but must be non-dual. The rishis realized this infinite non-dual self, the Atman, as the true self of man. Yama taught Nachiketa that the self in man is none other than the spirit behind the universe, which is described in the Vedas through the sacred symbol Om. Then he goes on adding color after color in its description of the pure Atman, which is Brahman, the only reality. The root cause of all the miseries of this world is ignorance or avidya. Na jayate va, na jayate, miyate va vipaschit. The Atman is not born. It does not die. It has not sprung from anything. Nothing has sprung from it. Birthless, eternal, everlasting and ancient. It is not killed when the body is killed. If the killer thinks he kills and if the killer man thinks he is killed, both of them do not know that the true self can neither be killed nor is able to kill. Atman is all pervading consciousness and the inner core of all things, great and small. Though dwelling in the body, it is bodiless. Though associated with changing things, it is unchanging. Naisha tarkena matirapaniya. One cannot know Atman either by means of my study or through a keen intellect. When the mind becomes pure through devotion and righteous action, through self-control and contemplation, it then becomes serene and reflects the majesty of Atman. Nachiketa was the talented student of Atmavidya, the science of self, under Yama, the wonderful teacher, Acharya Vakta Kushalose Labdha. The coming together of two such gifted minds resulted in lasting benefit to humanity at large. In the shape of immortal inspiration contained in the Kathopanishad. Yama continuing said that control of the mind and senses and not their repression is the most effective spiritual discipline for a man in the attainment of his spiritual goal. Atmanam rachinam viddhi shariram rathamevatu buddhim tu sarathim viddhi manah pragrahamevacha. The teacher gave the vivid illustration of a chariot which can take the rider to his destination only when it is well built, and when the driver, endowed with discrimination, restrains the impetuous horses by means of strong reins and guides them along the designated roads. Likewise, the body must be healthy, the intellect free from uncertainty, should control by means of a strong will. The naturally turbulent sense organs, and allow them to enjoy only those objects that are conducive to spiritual progress. Further, through meditation, the aspirant must acquire inwardness of mind and maintain an unwavering determination that will hold him to his journey till the goal is reached, for the path is sharp as the edge of a razor. And this verse of Kathopanishad was very favorite to Swami Vivekananda. Uttishthata jagrata prapya varanibodhat shurasya dhara nishita duratya durgam patastat kavayo vadanti. Atman dwells in the hearts of all and is a man's inmost essence. It animates his physical, vital and mental activities. It is the unaltered witness of his experiences during waking, dreaming and deep sleep. Though appearing to be identified with the functions of the body and the mind, it is transcendental. The attributes of the body do not cling to Atman, just as water does not cling to a lotus leaf. The knowledge of the deathless Atman, which Nachiketa wished to acquire from Yama, is itself immortality. Immortality is not produced by this knowledge. Anything that is produced has a beginning and an end and cannot be immortal. The self always exists, undiminished and undimmed, neither waxing nor waning through a man's good or bad actions. Like the sun, however, it can be hidden by the cloud of ignorance and is revealed when the ignorance is destroyed by knowledge. An illumined person, endowed with self-knowledge, attains deathlessness, though he may assume or discard the body at will, like a man putting on a garment or taking it off. Self-knowledge bestows knowledge, liberation from the suffering of phenomenal existence. When a mortal renounces his finite desires, which are created by ignorance and are alien to his self, he realizes immortality in this very life. Others remain victims of birth and death in the world of untruth. Therefore, anyone desiring freedom and immortality should separate the immortal self from the mortal body with the help of a steady and vigilant mind. When all the desires that dwell in his heart are destroyed, then mortal man becomes immortal and attains Brahman here in this very life. The Kathopanishad concludes in the last verse its account of the interesting dialogue between Yama and Nachiketa with a note of universal hope. It says, on receiving Atma Vidya and the entire discipline of yoga from the competent teachers like Yama, Nachiketa became free from all impurities and from death and attain Brahman. And so will attain anyone else also who will thus realize God. Since more than 1 year, we are facing the challenges posed by COVID-19 pandemic, I hope and pray that Bhagwan Shri Ramakrishna bless us all to overcome this pandemic at the earliest possible, and we will all live a happy and healthy life. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shantihi. Hari Om Tat Sat.